Leadership is about bringing a collective group of people together to achieve more.
It's about investing in the people that you're going to need in the future. And it's actually about creating a pathway.
And then thinking about how we need to manage our business model in order to remain viable.
Welcome to The Business Of. I'm your host, Emma LoRusso, and this leadership podcast is brought to you by the Australian Graduate School of Management at UNSW Business School. The events of 2020 have inspired much reflection on what the future will look like for the organisations we lead. For many of us, it's apparent the future of work is not on its way, it's already arrived. In this episode, we'll explore the now of work and how leaders need to innovate to create organisations that are more human, creative and resilient. Digital transformation, with all its complexity and disruption, plays an important role in this innovation and change. Joining me is David Thodey, former CEO of Telstra and Chair of the CSIRO. David's expertise and signature leadership style make him the perfect guest to discuss today's digital landscape and how it's shaping the organisations of tomorrow. I'll also speak with Deborah Young, founding CEO of the RegTech Association, an organisation facilitating the building of higher-performing, ethical and compliant businesses through innovative investment in regulatory technologies. And finally, I chat with Patrick Sharry, Chief Curiosity Officer at A Curious Drop and Program Director and Adjunct Faculty at the AGSM. Patrick has wide consultancy experience across public and private sectors, and he shares his insights and observations about how leaders need to be strategic and continue to evolve as the business world changes. But first, let's hear from David Thodey.
So, David, welcome to The Business Of.
Thanks, Emma. It's great to be here.
I mean, I think if anyone can talk to what are on the minds of board members and C-level executives and how they might be thinking about the future of work, it would be you. I mean, what do you think, given the challenging times, has that been accelerated, those conversations?
Yeah, look, definitely they have been accelerated, and I think we're still working through it, to be honest, Emma. I mean, I think it's caused me to think about how we communicate effectively. I think that, you know, I was going back to think about, you know, the introduction of the telephone. You know, I mean, the telephone prevented us from, well, allowed us not to have to go and physically see someone. And now with, you know, document sharing, video conferencing, shared whiteboards, being able to sort of interact in different ways, I think it has signaled a whole different way of how we communicate. And we've got to be careful in that, because some of it's good and some of it may not be as conducive to maybe innovative, creative thought.
That's a good point, because I think a lot of that change happened rapidly for organisations. They might have been talking about it, but they've had to just go straight into implementation mode to balance the human element and that creativity, like what makes it, where do those ideas come from, and that real future think that's, you know, that means we'll survive. How do organisations ensure that? What do you think the right conversations should be? What are the priorities or a focus lens that could be placed around that?
Look, the way that we have been approaching it is not with necessarily a recipe as a solution, but trying to work out how we can make effective decisions or have effective engagement to get to good decisions. Very, you know, disciplined, rigorous, you know, board meetings or just management meetings. And maybe we need a bit more asynchronicity in it. You know, maybe we break up the discussion from the decision making. We're only limited by our creativity in using the technology to help us be more effective in our communication and decision making. And don't get caught just, you know, the worst thing we can do is just continue to work and make decisions the way we used to, just on the screen, you know, just sort of moving it. Change it up. Think about it. So I think that's the critical thing. And use the technology to be more effective.
And you have so much exposure between, you know, CSIRO and your role there, and Xero and Tyro, and all the many things that I haven't mentioned, but that you, I know that you're part of. What do you think the skills of the future need to look like? How do we look to leadership to lead and bring in that human and creativity element so that they challenge the way things are done? What do you believe is required, or at least the discussion that will drive the, you know, this is what we're looking for?
Yeah, look, I think that the nature of work and how we lead does need to continue to evolve and change. Now, you know, as you know, I mean, leading people is a very human element. There's great ideas and there's great thought leadership, and we can be inspired. But at the end of the day, leadership is about bringing a collective group of people together to achieve more than they would as individuals. I mean, that's what a great leader does, and somehow they enable you to do beyond what you thought you could do. And hopefully that involves doing things differently, because the fundamental value in people working with people is to create differentiation, do things differently that then creates some value, hopefully economic, social, or maybe environmental. So I think we need to keep thinking about what great leadership looks like. There's some things I don't think will change. I think, you know, the art of, you know, self-awareness is really important. That's foundational. But the days of, you know, hierarchical, dictatorial command and control probably weren't even appropriate before COVID, but even more so is not appropriate now. So it's about how you provide vision and purpose that allows people to really exceed in their particular area of responsibility. So it's creating a climate of creativity, of ingenuity, of, you know, of enablement, rather than, you know, doing task-oriented things. So I think that's the nature of work, but I think it's going to be different doing it remotely. It's, you know, I think there's good and bad doing it remotely with people work from home. I mean, because you still need that human interaction. Even now, I need to be able to look at your eyes and except see how things are going. But there's other elements that people can work when they feel it's, you know, appropriate for them to work, with children and other pressures in their life. So I think that's a really positive thing. So I do think leadership needs to be flexible. You know, I'm trying not to use the word agile. but it is true. I mean, I can even remember at Telstra, we... it's a while ago now. I should be careful to use examples that are 5 years old. But, you know, we did try to go to a principle that all roles flex, that it you know, to redefine, you know, even if you're in the contact center or in a shop, that it, if you could work with your team to determine when it was appropriate for you to work and you could still sort of trade off, then that created a far better working environment. And this idea of having to be at your desk to determine how you're doing work is just archaic. So, but we do need to think about, you know, giving people flexibility, but there are times we need to be together. The question of creativity, how do you do creativity in a virtual world? Well, hopefully it's not always virtual, firstly, so hopefully we can come together. But, yeah, I haven't really nailed that one, Emma. I think you've got to go slowly. You've got to give people the opportunity to talk and express views. Maybe I read this morning that some people prefer doing a brainstorming session on video because they feel they get more airtime than some, you know, dominant individual who just takes up all the time.
I know, I mean, just as a personal kind of the way we hire now, it's just brought down to smart, talented, get things done, infinite learner, not an asshole. And that is it. Because you know, what they studied and what they've done before does not apply, right? You just need that time. You talked about flex, but it's it is the only way. But then you need to also be outcomes focused and remember, and particularly I think at this time, you know, that human, I don't know, it's, again, it's an observation, but I think this care from the well-being of your team has probably become much more front and centre than it has in the past, because this period has impacted people more greatly.
Oh, we've got to. I think it was, I mean, Gary Hamel wrote a book just recently called, well, he's a part author on humanocracy, you know, putting the human back in to business and relationship with customers. And I do hope that, you know, that that continues on. I think great companies have always had that, to be honest. I mean, it's hard as you grow and you become more diverse and, you know, global to keep that sense of, you know, human connection. But I also agree. I love you. I can't quite recite it, but yeah, outcomes driven, you know, kick ass, you know, let's get on with it. I mean, that's great because you still need that edge. You still need to get stuff done, but you need to do it in a way that, you know, appreciates human personalities, characteristics, etc.
For Australian businesses in particular, I know you've been a champion of, you know, this innovation coming from here and thinking global and those opportunities.
Yeah.
How does what's happened just recently help set us up to think differently? Have we been more introspective, or have we been able to actually think a little bit differently about our place in the world? And what would you hope for there?
Well, that's a big one. So let me just take it in two parts. One is our place in the world. We've got to remember Australia is what? 1.6 trillion GDP. We're 1.2% of the global GDP. We're a small nation.
0.33% of the global population. That's the one that I always remember.
That's right. All 25 million of us, you know, in a federation, you know, states competing with each other. So we've got to remember our place there, but we do have an incredibly well-educated, you know, community. We have a can-do attitude. I think Australians generally, if you look right across the board, you know, are willing to give it a go and step up. And I think that we were blessed with a wonderful resources sector, great agriculture, et cetera. But what we've not done is build our, I'll call it services, but what I mean is, you know, software-driven, biotech, health tech. It's all those sort of big domain thought leadership, building global industries. And, you know, except in the resources sector, only a few companies have truly gone global. Love CSL, love Cochlear. You know, the banks have tried it. They've sort of come back home. But when you start getting down to those mid-corporates, we're not as externally focused we need to do. And I think we need to both, you know, get into this sort of tech-driven, big services, knowledge-based, information-driven, you know, sectors and have a global perspective on it and say, well, why not? Especially when the connected world, tyranny of distance does not apply as much. You're still going to have to travel. So I hope that that is what is going to happen going forward. So I do think that's a big change. I trust, I mean, we've seen the take-up of technology, be it e-commerce, just trading online, other skills, has definitely risen. And you know that the tech sector, I mean, this is whether you call it Industry 4.0, whatever you call it, this technology-driven change across every sector, it's probably at best 25-30% of the way through. I mean, this is a seismic change in every industry. And when you look in Australia, of that 0.33% of the population, you know, Australia, of the global population, the tech sector is less than 5%. And most European countries are up around 7 or 8%, and the US is over 10%. And in terms of GDP contribution, at best we're 6% and we should be at 10%. So we need to, I think, pivot to that technology, knowledge-based industries, and not to throw resources away, not to throw ag away, and we'll do ag tech, et cetera, but we've got to build this other leg to the stool. And I'm worried that we're not going fast enough. I think there's just so much opportunity. And we're starting to see a little bit in Melbourne in the biotech area, seeing some here in Sydney. You've got a few, you know, technology, software-driven areas, but nowhere near as big as we need.
By the way, you're preaching to someone who's in violent agreement and
yes,
and a super champion of the same message. Yeah. But I mean, I'd love to hear, and I'm sure our listeners would, like, what do you think needs to be unlocked? Is that just the role of leadership? Is it government? Is it policy? Is it our education system? Is it, you know, and does it start at kindergarten on? Like, how much has to change to make this happen?
Well, look, like everything, it comes back to leadership. And I'm not one of those people who say that it's all around government policy, because I think government's saying, look, get on with it, you know, and we've got some great companies that are getting on with it. Now, there are a few impediments along the way that they need to tidy up as we go forward. But I do think we need to make it really attractive. To me, you know, if I talk around science and, you know, the whole research area, I mean, science is nothing more than trying to discover how our world works, isn't it? I mean, be it, you know, chemistry or biology or genetics, it's sort of actually, it's so exciting, and we just need to make it more exciting. And I think people will come. So I first will go to us and say, look, we need to step forward and say, this is great. And I know there are a lot of people who do that. Look, I do think that there is some responsibility for government where there's market failure. I think we can step in more. I mean, that's why I think, you know, New South Wales government setting up the tech centre around Central, you know, Tech Central is really exciting. I think, you know, they're putting in, what, 50 to 60 mil just to get it going. And I think if we as industry and we as leaders need to step into that. I know it won't be perfect. I know, you know, there'll be lots of things wrong with it, but let's take the, you know, the 80% that's good and really make it work. In terms of education, yeah, look, I think that we're not teaching, you know, exciting software skills at schools, unfortunately. Yeah, we're making it, you know, more by rote than anything else. And so we need to make that come alive. And that's why coding for kids and, you know, all those programs are so good. But we need to make it exciting and relevant to life, back to the humanity. If it's sort of something that's too theoretical, people will tune out. We've got to make it really live about what we're doing, purpose-driven, et cetera. So that's what I would say.
You talked about mid-corporate, and it starts with us as leaders. If you could say to, you know, to everyone who's listening and to every leader, what should they do to challenge themselves and challenge their organisation and be that leader of change that leads to that innovation and that global kind of thinking and competitiveness and make it exciting and purpose-driven? Like, what? How do you break that down? Because I know people who've worked with you, they are inspired by you. So what is your secret?
Number one is to care, you know. I mean, you've got to care. I mean, the first thing I've always done, I mean, I look at my own backyard and say, are we living what we talk about? Are we practicing it? And so you've got to do that. But then you've got to be willing to stand up and talk about it and step out and put yourself at risk a bit, you know. And too often, you know, a little bit of Australia tall poppy syndrome, not so much in this area, but a little bit, you know, step out and have an opinion, put it on the table and go and make a difference and invest a little bit back into the community from where you come from. So I think if we all did that just a little bit more, then the multiplier effect would be enormous. Now, you know, the other thing I get very frustrated with in Australia is, you know, and it comes back to this thing around, I don't know what it is. It's sort of the tall poppy syndrome, but you know, supporting each other. I mean, Emma, I think what you're doing is great. You know, I want to see you grow 10 times in whatever way you want to grow.
100 times, David. Don't limit my growth, please.
Yeah, do too. That's right. But, you know, we need to lift each other up. And too often I hear, states, you know, competing with each other. You know, people saying, oh, yeah, you know, David's a nice guy, but did you know, he doesn't do this or whatever. Build people up. I mean, the US go a little bit over the top on it, but we need to sort of encourage each other, step out and change the attitude. And so every day, find someone to support or say something good about and encourage them in the way, because it's too easy to be critical and then go do something about it. So three things, you know, make sure your backyard's okay, do it. Step out and make a difference and encourage other people to make a difference. Now, three things, and then we'll be all a lot better off.
I also heard you saying that, have the courage. Be uncomfortable, courage, like you talked about putting your opinion and maybe teasing out what things could look like. When do you feel uncomfortable, just out of interest? Like when do you feel like you, or how do you put yourself in check?
Yeah, I feel uncomfortable often. You know, I think the trick is how to put ideas out and not be offended if someone's got a better idea, you know, or so it's like having this learning, know, this constant learning attitude that, you know, it's great to learn and you may be wrong, you may be right. So when I'm, you know, down in Canberra with COVID Commission and Stephen Kennedy, Secretary of Treasury, is talking around economic modelling around, you know, the impact of JobKeeper. You know, I'm not an economist. I sort of know what's going on in the economy. And I feel decidedly out of my depth in terms of econometric modelling. But I can put an attitude out there about getting people back into work. How will that work? Asking open-ended questions, being involved. But, yeah, it's putting yourself at risk that where you find and you have courage to do that, that you learn and hopefully you contribute to a better outcome. Because that's what you want, the truth. It's not about me being right, not about you being right. It's about getting to the truth that will make a difference and a better for the, all, you know, for our nation and the greater world.
And when you've seen organisations make that transition, right? And, you know, Telstra would be a case in point, yeah. Right? Amazing innovation in that period of time. Were the frameworks that you adopted, was it creating that question-based, let's be driven by purpose? Like, what does that look like? Because I guess one of the outcomes I would love for this, post this talk, is that people actually go, hey, these are the, you know, I feel inspired, I have got the courage, but I know I need to bring my team along with me. Here's maybe a way that we can talk about it or set some context, or here are the pillars that we could be thinking about. Like, have you seen something that creates that start that you have observed change and maybe fast change?
Well, I do, but I'm not sure it's as formulaic as, you know, the textbooks would like us to think. So, look, I am a great advocate for purpose-driven companies. You know, I think purpose, you know, transcends economic return, you know, self, you know, introspective behavior, you know, being driven by something that leaves a mark on our society or, you know, in some way is really important because that's what gets us all going. And I mean, yes, I want to work hard, I want to do well, but you've got to know what you stand for, and finding that can be very hard. And doing it in a way that opens up opportunity doesn't close it down. Now, that's a little bit, you know, of a contradiction in terms, because any business needs to be good at what they do. But how you do it needs to be open and, you know, be able to get there in many different ways. And look, I know it's sort of popular these days, but culture plays a critical role in that. And the culture needs to be real to who you are as an organization. Just like, you know, in any society or nation, you're a product of your past, but you have choice for the future. So you can't deny your past, but you can create your future. So you've got to work off what is instinctively and innately you and then move it forward. So we spend a lot of time thinking about our purpose and you know, so for Telstra, it was not just being you know, a telecommunications company. It was about creating a brilliant connection with people. You know, so we got this human element. And by the way, if we had thought about that earlier, we might have built WhatsApp. We might have done, you know, even done things like, well, I don't know if we would have done Twitter, but we could have done communication and how we communicate in a completely different way. But we lost that because we were too slow in that. So I think in that process of purpose and culture, it sort of redefines who you are and then gives people the freedom to go and do things differently. But also, I mean, the reality of large complex organizations is you do need some guardrails. So it's like, let's talk around diversity. You can talk around diversity and I can say, you know what, gender equality. But until you go and look at the policies that you have, you can be just absolutely, you know, talking out of the side of your mouth, you know what I mean? And you need to have integrity in that. So you've got to go and say, well, look, are there policies or behaviors that are impeding us achieving what we want to do and be willing to change them? So it's not just all pie in the sky. It's actually hard, disciplined work. And it's the same with innovation. You know, I wish that I could say to the CSIRO scientists, well, you know, just go and have a really good creative session and come back and tell me how we're going to change the world. But the truth is, in science and in innovation and research, you actually may have to do things 1,000 times before you get to the 1,001 and first time. And hey, presto, you do something differently. So innovation and finding new ways to do things can be incredibly disciplined and hard work. And I, you know, I love it if you do just have that sort of moment of brilliance when you decide something or see something, but often it's just hard work. So I think it's from the visionary, purpose, culture, alignment, all the way through to discipline and rigor of running a company differently. And I think how you keep that balance is really important, because it can sort of get out of kilter really quickly if you don't watch it too.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a really brilliant point, is making sure it's congruent, that you're not, you know, what you're measuring is not in conflict to what you're asking. And like you said, that I think you call them the rail bars are there, but not the cap. You know, like they can go as far as they want, as long as, you know, you're not putting at risk or maybe these are the parameters. And I do wonder if, you know, you talked about asking the hard questions, and it is hard, right, to make that change.
But is
critical thinking part of that? Is it the art of saying no to the too many things, so you're saying yes to create the space for the right things? Is that part of what you think is both the rigor, but where organisations go wrong? Or where do they go wrong when they are trying to do this? What have you observed?
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, I thought you were talking to me, because I tend to say yes to too many things, Emma.
I've observed it in many places. And it's something you have to hold yourself to check as a leader. It's like there's lots of good ideas
absolutely.
And lots of business cases that can be built, but is this the one we want our limited resources to go after?
I really agree, yeah. And you've got to know how, you know, I do get enthusiastic and want to try new things, but I'm also very conscious execution is 96% of success, you know. And so you've got to do the vital few. So I do think prioritization, which includes yes and no, but being very clear on your priorities, because you can't do everything, is really important. And actually using, you know, good methodologies to think through what is most important, so that when you come back, it's not just my idea is better than your idea. We've thought it through and put parameters against it and be as much as we can data-driven, because then allows you to go back and review that decision about why you made, because you may have made a wrong decision, got wrong data. At least you can go back and say, well, we made that decision because, well, that was different. Okay, well, let's go do something different. So what have I seen that people, companies do wrong? Look, I listen, you know, to a lot of companies have great ideas, and then, you know, 2 years later they pivot and they go do different things. And I actually, at one point I was quite critical of that, but I think that is a really good sign. You know, you've got to be, you've got to have an idea, pursue it, but be willing to change it. You know, so it does come back to this flexibility and being absolutely ruthlessly honest about whether you are succeeding or not. And, you know, we all have this incredible ability to believe our own drivel, you know, and be willing, not in a critical way, but just what truth tells you, and be able to get that data. And then if it's not working, to change, which is coming back to your point around focus and yes and no, and then be willing to move forward. And I think the companies who don't do that are the ones who do fail, because they stay true to something that is not going to yield the value that they wanted to. Now, that's different to something being really hard but right to do, and you've just got to stay the course. And sometimes that is really hard, and there'll be a lot of people around you saying, no, you're never going to succeed, David, you know, and you've got to be strong internally to say, no, we can do this. We're going to find a way through it. So that's slightly different again. But, yeah, I think that's so there's sort of two parts. One is be ready to change if it's not working. And two, have enough resilience, old word in leadership. But, you know, stay the course and believe in yourself and have the courage to go do what you've got to do, and then use all the methodologies and the help you can get along the way.
So much food for thought. Thank you for joining us today on The Business Of.
My pleasure.
This is The Business Of. a podcast looking at what it means to do well and do good in the world of business. It's always a pleasure to speak with David Thodey. It's clear from our conversation that in order to lead progressive, future-ready organisations, leaders require clarity, calm, confidence and compassion. And I loved the examples he gave of how this translates to better business outcomes. My next guest has mobilised all these characteristics to build an organisation critical to the digital landscape we're operating in. Let's hear from Deborah Young on the story behind the RegTech Association and the reasons it's grown from having just 8 members to 150 in just 3 years. So Deborah, welcome to the Business Of.
Thank you so much, Emma. So good to see you.
And such an amazing journey. So let's start with, tell me about RegTech Association that you founded and are CEO of.
Yeah, so it was founded in 2017 as a non-profit association. And the small group of founders were pretty focused at that time around, they had a vision and a mission. And they were to accelerate adoption of RegTech and to create a global centre of excellence. And I must say, back in 2017, that seemed like an enormous mountain to climb, because it was just such a small group of people who had the passion behind it. So we created the association 3 years ago, and we're now 150 organisations, which is simply massive from where we started at my kitchen table.
So first of all, for those that don't know what RegTech is, can you just unpack it for them? And then what's driven that amazing growth in just 3 years?
So we would say RegTech is defined as any technology that supports better regulation and better compliance. So it's really that simple. And of course, it's really that complicated then, because that is actually a very broad range of solutions. But I think, you know how they say in life that timing is everything. And certainly at the time that the association was founded was right at the beginning of the announcement of the Hayne Royal Commission. And so that was the early wind beneath the wings as regulators and regulated entities were looking at how they could do things better. And so the association kind of was able to ride the crest of that wave. And what we were offering was actually a curation of the technology like had not been seen before. So in other words, we were able to bring everybody together to have a more meaningful conversation than everybody trying to do it individually, door knocking and speaking to the wrong people at the wrong time. So I think it was about timing. And then certainly over the last 6 months, the pandemic has actually driven this next significant wave in interest in RegTech. And it's mostly because this is now impacting government. And when something will actually impact government, then we will start to see things happening as we've seen over the last 6 month period.
What drives that awareness around needing to plan against risk and have this regulation and understand the governance and the importance of it? Why do organisations need it?
They need it for a number of reasons. And yes, it's definitely for good governance. It's definitely for compliance to regulation. I mean, there's some of the big ticket items, because we've seen the size of the fines for non-compliance. But actually RegTech, this is why I love RegTech, because it can actually improve the way people are doing their jobs every day. So if you're working in compliance or in regulation in some way, these are tools that can actually help you focus on higher order tasks and not focus on all of the perhaps lower level risks, but actually to get some visibility over what the risks are to begin with. So this is actually about tools to actually help equip people to do their jobs better. And actually further along, this is actually securing trust for the whole of the regulated ecosystem. So that's why it matters. And then further on, even from that, this is actually about people and about people needing trust in their life. Like you and I want to feel that when we're interacting with our institution, irrespective of what that institution might be, it could be a bank, it could be an energy company, it could be a telco, you are assuming that you're operating in 100% trustworthy environment. And what RegTech can do is back that up all through the value chain to ensure that you can have that experience and that trust.
And you touched on government too, and particularly with COVID, that this has been another period of growth. Can you explain why and how have they engaged and how fast can change happen?
Well, I think we've just proven over the last 6 months that change can happen really quickly when everybody's pulling, you know, in the right direction. And I think it touched the government in a number of ways. So, for example, I think digital identity went up the importance chain, and we remember seeing the news reports of thousands of people standing outside Centrelink offices queuing up. And this was simply because they needed to be identified and there was no other way of doing it except to ask them to actually risk probably catching COVID by standing in a very long queue to go and have their identity verified, amongst other things, I've no doubt, but it was certainly one of the things. So being able to identify people. Then we look at some of the other things that have happened during the pandemic, like the early release of super. And so I think KYC, or know your customer, has also gone up the food chain as well. So if I worked for a bank or a financial institution and I was operating from home, you know, have we covered off the security and the trust, especially if I'm in a regulation or a compliance-based role? I've got lots of sensitive data coming to me, as an example. So I think that the safety around how we collaborate and the transfer and flow of information has been heightened as well. So I think that there are three really good reasons why the government wanted to kind of focus on reg tech. And it felt like one day the phone didn't ring and then the next day the phone was ringing hot.
I mean, that last statement is really about that opportunity. Why are we doing it? It's to serve our customers better or to serve our people better. How do you help organisations see that planning against risk versus opportunity? And who's the leader that you're talking to that needs to think about that differently and make that change?
That's a really interesting question. I think first and foremost, I'll go back to government just for a second. I think that the government has actually just recognised what their role is in RegTech, because the government potentially 2 years ago were treating this as a new and exotic thing, not quite sure what to do with it. But in actual fact, when you think about the very top of the tree is actually the government, because the government are creating the requirement for RegTech. They're making the policies, they're making the laws that get handed to the regulators to administer. The regulated entities are then needing to report to that, to those regulators, and RegTech is trying to get in the middle to reduce the friction. Now, when we talk about who's actually responsible within organisations, RegTech has probably moved around a little bit in areas of responsibility, but more and more we're starting to see leading institutions actually having chief data officer, chief compliance officer. So no longer would it just sit with the chief risk officer as it may have traditionally done, but there are new roles that we can see being created. And one of the very powerful things, in fact, I heard a bank say this the other day, they're no longer a place that you go to get money. Banks have become these big organizations full of data for all kinds of reasons and for all kinds of things. And so we can see that a chief data officer is going to have a very big interest in RegTech. So it's actually, I think it's still emerging as to where RegTech will rest, and maybe it won't ever be with one area of responsibility. But certainly we're seeing the financial services regulators in particular all are running active RegTech programs. And so they're about educating, they're about surfacing what are the solutions. And whilst they don't endorse any particular solution, they want to surface that and make sure that education is there so that people can see the potential of what's possible so that they can monitor the risks more actively.
And Deborah, because I've seen you personally bring about change, right? You've done it in many organisations, even before the RegTech, and I've had the privilege to view and see this. What advice do you give people when they do need to think differently or to lead change or to introduce something that might require investment, but of course the outcome is so great? Like, how have you personally led that? And what's your journey been to realise that as an outcome?
Well, the first thing is, I think, you know, you have to recognize that people, despite the fact that I represent a tech, you know, like an area of the tech sector, and some people might say, well, you know, is that really about people? Absolutely. This is actually about investing in people. It's about investing in the people that you have now. It's about investing in the people that you're going to need in the future. And it's actually about creating a pathway. I mean, all jobs have an evolution. From where I first started in my career is definitely, you know, not where I've ended up. And so we will evolve over that. And what we're also going to see is organizations, there's going to be a blurring of the lines, and we're already starting to see it. Technology companies becoming banks, banks becoming technology companies. And so all of a sudden we're seeing the blurring of these lines. We must be nimble. You know, it has to be making better business decisions based on having the facts and the information and the data for you to do that. And so that's my message. Invest in your people, take a data first strategy, and also, you know, stay positive, try and stay positive, go for a walk every morning. And if you have to, go for several walks a day, take the time out. Because I think, especially during this time, our mental health has been very important.
Yes, probably more so than ever. Absolutely. I mean, I think there's a lot of change that has happened, to your point. We've accelerated, right? The last COVID's created this acceleration. How do organizations need to be thinking about their investment in technology to embrace every aspect, including, you know, the reg tech compliance component of it?
So I think organisations need to have a very deep understanding of, you know, their problem statements or their challenge areas. And I think they need to take all areas of their business, their people, their tech, and align against what those problems are. And then also they've got to make some pretty important decisions about whether to buy or build. And one of the interesting things for large institutions right now, they may even have access to investment capital through a corporate venture arm or something like that. And so there may be some interesting things about, should they actually be using some of the investment capital from that fund to invest into technology companies that can help the overarching parent address some of the greatest compliance or regulatory challenges that they have. And the other thing I would say is that organisations should reach out to their peak body or their industry association. It's a wonderful way that they can roll up their sleeves, get involved. They will have a natural peer group within that community, and being able to harness that sometimes is the greatest way that you can get wholesale change made across a very a diverse group of organisations, in my experience. And I think this is like my sixth industry association that I have worked for, and I am generally passionate about harnessing the power of everybody, you know, to create the change and momentum that's needed.
You talked about investment in this technology and some of those decisions that get made around that. What are some of the returns? Like, what should they be looking to when they're considering this for the future?
So one of the case studies that I learned about just recently involved a reg tech company, a UK regulator, and a couple of banks, and they ran a trial, a manual process that took 1,000 hours. And they put it next to the process that the RegTech was able to do and was able to achieve the same result in 2.5 minutes. So when you're talking about a return on an investment, it's pretty clear that there's a lot of productivity and efficiency that can be achieved in a shorter amount of time. And then imagine you would have all of that additional time to look and analyze that data. So those results that you've just been given, what else, you know, could you achieve, you know, having, you know, being given all of that time back? So I think that is a great example of RegTech at its finest, brings you the productivity, efficiency. Bang, you've already made 5 business decisions based on that information that you didn't have to, you know, invest that 1,000 hours.
I mean, the power of making better decisions, more informed decision is key in how we're going to operate into the future. So, Deborah, because, you know, you're an amazing leader, I'd love you just to give your best piece of advice to other people leading change in their organisations. What would that be?
Well, would it surprise you to know that you must bring diversity to your table? I see it so often, and it's almost like because we've had the pandemic, you know, we don't need to worry about plastic bags anymore, and we don't need to worry about diversity anymore because we've got bigger fish to fry and we just should be grateful for whatever we get. You know, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to say, look, certain groups here are not represented, because the organisations that I see that are thriving really have good diversity or have made a commitment to better diversity. And that doesn't just mean, you know, gender diversity, that can mean diversity from a whole host of other things as well. It could be people with different abilities, you know, all kinds of things. So I think diversity is the one thing that I feel most passionate about, and you will get better business outcomes if you can be a more diverse organization. And it will actually help you in some way to actually better serve your customer as well.
Well, Deborah, thank you very much. It was lovely interviewing you and learning the opportunities for businesses and the acceleration that's happened. And to your success, congratulations.
Thank you so much, Emma. It was lovely to talk to you today.
This podcast is brought to you by the Australian Graduate School of Management at UNSW Business School. Fascinating to hear from Deborah on how leaders can manage the risk and compliance issues unearthed by this period of digital transformation and the importance of investing in your people as well as technology. An oft-repeated mantra is that a good crisis should never go to waste. And that's something my final guest has observed in his consultancy work during this period of digital acceleration. Let's hear from Patrick Sharry on how organisations are responding to the now of work and the technology shaping new products, services, and business models. So, Patrick, welcome to the Business Of.
Yeah, nice to meet you.
I mean, you work closely with a lot of senior executives and organizations, particularly around leading digital transformation and using that for innovation for their organization. What do you see as the common challenges, adoption, opportunities, and how is that being viewed today?
So there's a particular lens on this from a COVID-19 perspective. And there are, I don't know if a lens, well, a lens has two sides. There are two sides to that lens. One is that people are really struggling to make sense of what they need to do and what's the right direction to point any transformation. But also, I'm doing a lot of work with organisations at the moment, and they're saying that, you know, like a good politician would never waste a good crisis, they're leaping into the opportunity that the uncertainty of the coronavirus world has provided. And what they're doing is, in some cases, accelerating by 2, 3, 5 years, the way that they thought they needed to change their organisation, their business model, their structure, all of those sort of things, and they're doing it now. And so there's a real intensity in that, with people recognising that while the initial moments of the uncertainty were unpleasant and it's not completely wonderful now, it also provides an opportunity to drive a whole lot of change while everyone is more open to change than they might ordinarily be.
And I think that's a bit of the secret, right? It's the open to change and then maybe using technology and seeing how they serve their customers. Who is doing it well? Where do you see organisations? What questions do they ask to accelerate or to use this as the opportunity hidden in this hardship?
So without a doubt, the big changes around digitisation of business models. You know, there's a number of different aspects to that, but one of the main pieces would be automation and its cousins, machine learning and those sorts of things. And those changes then drive structural changes in the organisation and require new skill sets to keep that automation moving, because it's not a once-off thing. Mm. It's a journey that you are on. And you need to keep working at that. And that, as I said, requires new skills and organisations are getting better at recognising that.
Is it all organisations you're working with? Do you think some of the urgency that was there at the start is sustainable and leading to continuous change, looking further enough into the future?
The change won't stop in the next 6 months. This is, you know, a journey that we've been on, and all that's happened is that we've accelerated it. One of the things that I'm conscious of, you know, organisations in different spaces is, particularly in a time when we're acutely aware of the impact of coronavirus on employment or unemployment, the automation process actually can make that a lot worse. Mm. In that you know, you automate a process and it's not a one-for-one match by any means, but you often end up with a smaller workforce or a different workforce. And so in all of this, there are also ethical challenges. There's the need to recognize the societal impact that you have as a as an organization. And there's a balancing out here of how do we reduce the cost of the business as much as we can, but still keep a place as a contributor to the broader societal need to have employment and people engaged in meaningful work.
So how do you help organisations get to the far enough ahead to see what the future can look like to be able to effectively balance that?
So one of the things I'm doing quite a bit with organisations at the moment is building scenarios about what the future might look like. So we'd be foolish to think that we can, you know, with laser-like accuracy, pinpoint what the future is going to be. What good scenario planning does is acknowledges that and says that we should be building a series of plausible futures about how our broader business environment might play out, and then thinking about how we need to manage our business model in order to remain viable in those different settings. And that's useful because it sort of takes the blinkers off the belief that we could just have that one view. And importantly, cognitively, what it does is it leverages a thing called the availability heuristic. And that means that people in the management team, for example, become a lot more aware of the things that are happening out there in the environment, and they bring those back to the management table to have more meaningful conversations about the future and our business model. If you tie that with a deep sense of purpose in an organization, then you can start to get that balance, because these things are not in any way straightforward. They're always a series of trade-offs, not just one trade-off. But making those things explicit means that you can actually make sensible decisions in really difficult environments.
I'm really glad you talked to that kind of scenario, look far enough into the future to try and put some context around it. Does technology drive strategy sometimes, or should strategy always drive technology? So I'm curious, what have you seen, and when does one play a more important role than the other?
If this was a multiple choice, Emma, the answer would be E, all of the above. it absolutely goes both ways. The technology can drive the strategy can drive the technology. The quality of that loop is dependent in no small part on the caliber of the executives that you've got, ones who are actually able to do that forward thinking and are open to ways of working that they might not have grown up with. So particularly for, you know, those of us who've got grey hair and have been around for a little while, it can be easy to sort of ignore all of the technology things, but good leaders know that it's actually critical to engage with that stuff.
Two good points there, bringing the right people to the table, and good leaders will be putting themselves in, I guess, uncomfortable situations, going into spaces that they don't know. What do you think are the characteristics for leadership? What's required of organisations? Because as you said, change is going to happen anyhow. So what do you think are the right leadership qualities or the culture of an organisation to think about digital transformation and innovation?
You know, like all good questions, the answer, Emma, is it depends.
I learned that when I did my MBA.
So part of this is to acknowledge that different approaches to leadership work more effectively in different settings, or to turn that around, that different settings require different leadership styles or the exercising of leadership in a different way. So, if you think of what we've seen in the particularly the early days, although it's continuing, of the coronavirus situation, in that sort of chaotic setting, what matters is really clear direction, ideally with some expert justification for that. And I think our state premiers have done a great job of that. At the federal level, we've done a great job of that. You know, could we be better? Yeah, we could. It's a bit difficult to be perfect in those settings, but we've done a pretty good job of that. If you look at other jurisdictions, that hasn't happened. You know, you can really see that difference. when we begin to move out of this, and so I'm a, you know, I think the way that Jacinda Ardern is talking about this is really constructive. She's not talking about bouncing back. She's talking about bouncing forward. The river changes. We can't recreate stuff. And so we've got to acknowledge that and say, well, we can't bounce back. We've got to create some new thing. And to do that, the effective exercise of leadership there is about being much more consultative, which is not to sit back and let other people make the decisions, but rather to know that there's no silver bullet that an individual leader is likely to have, rather getting the right people around the table and really listening to what's being said, being comfortable that at least in the early stages of that, there'll be a whole lot of tension and paradox and ambiguity that needs to be resolved, and entering into that, therefore, with a strong sense of humility is what's going to be important. But again, as we've seen, I think, really powerfully with Jacinda Ardern, the fact that you are consultative, the fact that you are humble doesn't mean that you're weak. You need to maintain the pressure on the system to drive the outcomes, but you can do that from a sense of humility in a consultative way, because it's important as an organisation or a society enters these times of change that we try and bring people with us. And the more we engage them going into that journey, the more they'll stay engaged when we're on the way.
I think the other beauty in that bounce forward is it's yet to be fully defined, right? Whereas if you say bounce back, you think that somehow you can control what was there. And as you say, everything changes around it. Where have you seen emerging technologies help an organisation, whether it's help them set their align to their strategy or hint to the future? Like what does that look like, and when is it done well in your view?
So the thing that comes to mind immediately, an organisation that I'm working with who've recently brought on board some new technology leaders, and they have made incredible improvements in the turnaround times for and the quality of customer service by using bots of various types in the sort of fairly common way, where the bot over time learns to be able to answer 30, 50, 70, 80% of inquiries, and they get dealt with really quickly, and that therefore frees up the time of staff members to provide better quality customer service, because the pressure's not on, to those customers who actually need a more detailed and thoughtful response. And, you know, that sort of thing, I think, works really, really well. Let the robots do what the robots are good at, the chatbots in this sense, and let the people do what the people are really good at, and bringing those together is what's successful.
Are there a set of questions leaders could use to help them understand technology, emerging technology, disruptive technology, to see where it sits?
That's a really difficult one, Emma. That's a really difficult one. One comment that I will make is that all of these conversations, including the ones that are driven out of coronavirus with the technology added in, are causing organisations to reflect on their identity. So who really are we? And what I try to encourage organisations to do in that space is to think about what's their real social purpose. Because if an organisation can be really clear on its social purpose, that becomes the guiding light for decisions that you make about technology and a whole lot of other things as well. I'm enjoying very much conversations that I'm having with organisations that are around that. Many of us have experienced through this whole ISO lifetime a lot of reflection about, you know, what do I really want to do in that bouncing forward sense? And organisations are doing a lot of the same thing. Good organisations are using that as a chance to think about what their social purpose is, and then to use that reinvigorated sense of social purpose to drive business decisions as they navigate into that uncertain future.
Patrick, I love that you said that because it's almost like the guiding first principles for decision making or leadership frameworks of if you can know who you are and who you serve, then maybe you can ask the right questions of what may be in the technology. So thank you. That was great to hear. And I think you've made it less scary and more about that future state. I love the scenario planning. That feels low risk for people to start there, to have these conversations and tie it to purpose. Thank you so much for joining us on The Business Of.
Thank you.
The Business Of is brought to you by the Australian Graduate School of Management at UNSW Business School.
I hope you enjoyed my conversation with Patrick. I particularly liked his point about scenario planning and the idea of linking it with a deeper sense of organisational purpose to create meaningful dialogue and change throughout an organisation. It's clear from listening to our guests that it is no longer enough to be talking about the future of work. Instead, leaders need to take their learnings and ways of working now and use these as foundation elements to take their organisation forward. The future of work is here now. Leaders need to invest in new skills and industries to grow their organisations and help them thrive in a period of continuous change. Remember, technology is critical, but people remain your smartest investment. I'm Emma LoRusso. I'll talk to you next time on The Business Of. If you've enjoyed this episode of the podcast and want to hear more, search for The Business Of on your favourite podcast app and subscribe.